Let's go over to our man, Mr. Teddy Kegstad, as we do each and every Wednesday at 40 past the hour. You can reach Teddy every trading day, folks, at forex-trading-unlocked.com. That website is forex-trading-unlocked.com. Teddy Kegstad, what's going on, brother?
Oh, it's a good day to talk about the currencies. They were kind of quiet right before we came on the air with you here, and now all of a sudden we got some breakouts, like in the U.S. dollar, Canada, it just exploded to the upside.
Oh, yeah, that's a beautiful thing. Let's take a look at that, baby. So what do you think's happening there?
You know what? I think it's been consolidating for the past 2 weeks. I think they finally got a little breakout, you know?
Okay.
This just was building up. You know, you can only go sideways for so long. I mean, it's been, yeah, a good, I think, 9-10 sessions of pretty much staying within a 50-cent range. So, and now we made a higher move high.
Look
but
at
I think it's because we have a little bit of mixed dollar news, you know, today, now that the coronavirus seems to be stabilizing.
Okay.
So I think you're seeing dollar strength in a lot of your minor crosses right now.
Oh boy, I can't see it on the chart. Can you tell me where that bar moved? No, I joke. We got it up, Teddy.
We got
quite
it up,
quite
Teddy.
A move. Yeah.
That is a monster move,
seriously.
Huh?
So, right?
You know, in the foreign currency market, a move like that, is that, I know we're going to speculate on that, is that basically a large player coming in, all of a sudden saying, okay, in this case, they're going to sell the Canadian dollars? What makes something like move that quick? I mean, is it just a crowd coming in simultaneously selling?
You know what? I think it is. I think it's some sort of fundamental where there's some sort of rotation going on. I mean, we have the Davos, thing that started this week.
Yes.
There's really nothing fundamentally or technically going on to drive the Canada out of this little range that it's been in.
Okay.
It was just tightening and winding.
Right. Pretty amazing.
I think its stops got hit, and all of a sudden there was just a volume there, and that kind of pressed it.
And if you're looking at that chart, at TFN, folks, this is counterintuitive when you're looking at the currencies, okay? So as this goes higher, that's a weaker Canadian dollar versus the U.S. dollar, and that's what we're talking about here. So it's pretty wild when, you know, you look at these charts, right, that in the currency market, Teddy, do you know what I mean? Because we're trading the equities or futures. A lot of these get counterintuitive that you're going higher, but you're really going lower.
Sure. Right.
You know. Exactly. Yeah. And I think this is right now still a corrective phase, so I think it might be a blow-off rally.
Okay.
Because if you look at, like, the pound today, all of a sudden, now that market's been going sideways. We have the Brexit deadline next Friday, or next week on the 31st. So with that coming in, you would think it would be going sideways, and now finally today that had a nice little surge to the upside.
Yeah. Right.
So, but I think the one you really got to look at for traders right now is that I think this Canadian is going to, now that it finally broke out of this range,
yes,
you're going to start to have some swing trades develop, you know, which is kind of nice.
Okay. And the euro, man, is just laying there, isn't it? I mean, that thing hasn't done a thing. Well, actually, it's down. It's at the lower end of its consolidation today. Yeah.
It's the Italian woes, you know, because think about this. Today you have the pound that's very strong. You have kind of a mix. The dollar's index is stronger today slightly, but you have the pound that's rallying very nicely.
Yeah.
So that's being all offset. The euro itself is only, I think, down 8 pips on the day, something like that, which is very nominal, you know. So, but I think that the new woes with the Italian government and with things that are going on there, that's going to start to weigh on the euro-U.S. dollar trade.
Well, that makes sense. We haven't heard of the Italians not paying their bills for like 20 years. So this used to be a big thing, Tom, that the Italian, it was always the end of the world. First the Italians were going to go down, then this was, if I've learned anything over the course of years, like, none of these countries go down.
Sure.
Do you know what I mean? But that's in the news today, right? I mean, that's what
right.
we get.
And it seems to be always in front of springtime when this starts with Italy or Greece. It's always right after the first of the year, right before springtime.
Yeah, isn't it? It's wild, man. I mean, if Greece if I learned anything, if Greece didn't go down, that was supposed to be the end of the world. What was that, 9 years ago? I mean, that was supposed to be like everyone was broke.
Yeah.
They were crucifying the Greek people for having a good time in their villages. And then it's like, okay, man, you know. That's over, you know.
They're going to like you. They're going to have to get you on Greek TV, man.
Well, I love the Greeks.
You must, I know.
I did it
when I was a kid.
I'm not kidding.
They got quite a debt load over there for their GDP.
I'm not kidding. When I learned how to move in the streets of Boston, man, it was Greeks that took care of me, man. They showed me how to sell food.
You know, it's funny you mentioned the debt load because I was listening to a little bit of the Davos thing. They had the new head of Deutsche Bank, and he was talking about, you know, how with the negative interest rates in Europe, especially, and with the corporate bond yields, this is eventually going to be an appetite for destruction one day when it starts to turn, you know? I mean, the reality is he was putting it out really point blankly. He's like, the public is lending out $100 to get maybe $98 back in the future. at best, and that's where it's at right now.
Well, you were talking about this morning, right?
Jamie Dimon was out there in an article saying, you know, the one thing I fear is negative interest rates, because basically, to surmise it, he says, that's not the way things work, man.
Right.
He's like, I will never lend money to get less money back.
Right.
And
it's
just that simple, really.
It really is.
It really is.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Well, you know what? Traders have been talking about this literally for now 20 plus years. We've been saying as rates got lower, especially as when the Treasury bonds got above par value, I kept saying, telling people, I'm like, how is it that all these economists are such genius trying to sell the public something that's worth less when it comes due?
Right.
It doesn't make sense.
And they sold it. That's the thing. It's amazing.
And they sold it.
The only reason they teach you in school, like I said this morning on the show, the only reason you're supposed to save is so you can consume more later.
Right.
You know, you either consume or you save because you can have more later to consume.
Right.
You don't save so you can consume less in the future, because otherwise you should be consuming now. You know, it's save or consume.
Right.
The fundals, you know, economics. Oof.
Amazing.
Talk about blowing that up. Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
You got to get to the yen, man. What's going to happen here? We've been laying here.
The yen, I think it's right now, it's floating under these new highs, and I think it's basing. It's just going to be, no matter what the dollar index does, I'm a bull with the U.S. dollar yen right now. I think it's going up to about 112 half, 113, definitely over the next month and a half.
Yeah,
for
you,
sure.
You can see it, man. It does not want to get back underneath this 109.71. It's so close, but I saw it struggling yesterday, and that number, folks, that's kind of like a benchmark, because it broke out of that area, and as Teddy's saying, 112's the move, man.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what's up.
But
there.
I have a tiger trade for you. Remember last Friday when I filled in for you, Tom?
Yes.
One of your people wanted me to look at the peso, so I looked at the peso, and I've been watching the U.S. dollar versus the Mexican peso, and I'll tell you what. That thing, he was asking about, is it ready to buy?
Did Carlos call you?
Yeah, you know what? I'm not sure who the caller was.
We have a lot of guys down at the border coming. That's awesome, man. Okay, cool.
So, I'm very bearish the U.S. dollar peso. Like, it's kind of funny. I was in Mexico literally almost 3 years ago, like to the date, and that was when the peso was around 21 pesos to the dollar.
Yeah.
And now I'm looking at it, it's, you know, right around, it's, what is it, 1867?
Strong. Yeah.
And it looks like it's going to start tanking in a big way. Like, if you got anyone going to Mexico over the next, like, year or two, I think it's going to get more and more costly for sure. I think the peso has a good chance of getting down to 16 pesos to the dollar.
That's so cool to know, man. I mean, I like it.
The monthly does not look good at all. It looks like it's just ready to just fall over.
That's so cool, man. So you're going, and when Teddy says that, that just means a stronger peso, folks. That's the bottom line.
Right.
16, you're looking for that to break that whole consolidation. Man, if it breaks that consolidation, I can see 15.58, you break the consolidation.
And to bring it along, right, $1 used to get you 21 pesos, which is great.
Yep.
Now
$1
gets you only 18, $1 might get you 16. You can see how more costly.
And that's if you get a good conversion.
That's right. Carlos made a lot of money. He was buying that real estate at 21, or 22.
There we go.
Yeah, totally. Teddy, thank you so much, man. You have a great one. Safe one. Stay warm. We look forward to speaking to you next Wednesday. Thanks, man.
Thanks, Teddy.
Take care.
Stay right there, folks. Tommy and I come right back.